Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of 10 Minutes on Digital Wellbeing, the online IT magazine. Today we have Mr. Tony Nirasimha, the CEO of MIT. Mr. Nirasimha, first let's go back to 1996. Can you briefly explain about how MIT started?
Yes, sir. Thank you for the question. In 1996, MIT was the first, or maybe MIT was the first employee-owned company. It was a division of the open system of computer land, where myself and all the employees that worked in worked that company from the owners. And it was the first employee, as I said, it was a private company. And for anybody to work in that company at that time, they had to put some money in the company. So it is not only the professionals that invested, the drivers and the peers, voluntary investors. So this is the first company, I should say, the world, where everybody was a stakeholder.
What are the major areas that MIT is currently involved in?
Well, as you know, we are in the capital market industry. We are migrating the London Stock Exchange to our new platform, the trading system. We're also doing projects, one in Canada, doing a smart hardware system, one in the USA, doing algorithm training in the fixed income market. We're also involved in projects in India. We're automating a commodity exchange that will go live in the next month or so. We are also involved in a project in Egypt where we are doing the surveillance system. And we are in the process of also signing up journalist development system in the German structure. So there are a lot of projects that MIT is currently involved in. But everything, as we said, is so it's in the capital markets.
Talking about you, Mr. Yasin, where did you go to school and your higher studies and your support activities?
Well, I went to St. Thomas's, started in school. I did many sports, probably still go there, but I have 6 cars. I play rather than playing hockey, badminton, athletics, everything came to sportsman at the time, but I was in the boarding room, but the players were around. That experience became quite a good boy, it was chasing the board. On high studies, as you have that time, as it's still now, I want to do engineering, but didn't get into university to do engineering because I didn't get the marks. I got to do something like I was given some engines, but I never went to use in Sri Lanka. That was not interesting. I did BCS at that time, which is quite popular there. And of course, all my other things on professional courses
London Stock Exchange was able to acquire MIT. Can you tell our readers about the success stories?
Well, I think it's a great success story for millennials starting the Sri Lankan company. It became very evident to me that the world marketplace has changed. Today, our competition, we were competing not with software vendors anymore, but with exchanges. So our competition was less than performance. On massive events. And it became very difficult for me to compete because people didn't buy systems for technology anymore. They won't have a partnership with a large exchange. So there was a stage that I was thinking either we should change our focus and get to another market, or we have to find an exchange that we become a partner and lead this business. So I started London Stock Exchange because it's a very high IT department. And I think it surprised me that I managed to pull it off. But I always said millennial technology is proven to be world class. What we lacked was our balance sheet. We are really sure that in the world we are very small. So if our balance sheet is fixed, we will be much larger days. And that's what's happening from the day that London Stock Exchange. amounts. We are actually tripling our revenue in 1 year, and we actually most of the work as we are all over.
What kind of passion do you expect from the employees of the
company? Well, one of the things, the culture in my team is very different, and I'm very proud to say that when they did the due diligence, they sent professionals from top consultants and fellow to give assessment of MIT. And one of the reports said that MIT makes Accenture a genderless company. And that means we are much more professional than they have to have part of the day. Another report said that MIT is a very happy company. Employees are really happy. So the culture is different. So what I expect from them is, as I said, if you take today, probably I'm the least qualified guy to leave in MIT. MIT won't recruit me today. We're all of us plus graduate staff that is in this place. So they are aware of intelligence of people. So what we do here is we measure that intelligence. We don't tell them what to do. We only give them guidance, and we don't tell them this is how exactly. So we give them a creative to be unique in what they do. And I think that becomes a passion for them because they take ownership. So we have created a culture that you can really contribute and be proud that you contribute to something unique that the world has not seen.
What are your views on ending of war in Sri Lanka and its positive impact on businesses?
Well, if you look at Sri Lanka traditionally, Sri Lanka is a country that people in this region were very scared. If you look at Singapore, they wanted to be like Sri Lanka in the 1960s, and that's what people understand. But unfortunately, this war, and unfortunately, scenario has actually brought us down. So, ending the war now, I think if you look at it, everyone is expecting Sri Lanka to go. They're looking for it to come back to the emotion. And I think the positive sentiments are very strong. For a company like us, we can now win our merit. Earlier we had to fight not only on merit, but to give them assurance that don't worry, we are there to stay. And there's not going to be much issues in Sri Lanka, but to see the difference is not forgetting that it happens in India. So that's one off. And I think with the right courses and the right direction, Sri Lanka will be tightly completed.
What is the road ahead for you?
Well, at MIT, road ahead is we are innovating more and more products. We basically plan to grow the company. We had a dream of becoming a $1 billion company. And we are on board because still the land structure supports us. The conditions we are kept separate, we are not dependent on it. And we are not going through them. So we very much run like the lending that it was running before with a much bigger balance. That's not the difference. No management change, there are other places, and all the people in the company are still in the managers. So we are on the road to become, we have set up a target in the next 3 years. We want to achieve that. And we have all projects planned to expand in the MIT. And that's our goal. So when I started this company, I keep changing my goals, but my last goal was to at least have $100 in this MIT, which I won't achieve, but I hope that I can do it in the next 3 years, so that there can be many more million MIT startup to grow out.
There are many small companies in Sri Lanka, which has a great potential to succeed in India. Do you have any plans to help those companies to succeed and shine like
MIT? Well, one of the reasons I don't know we're there today at the conference that I'm basically saying one of the biggest problems is capital for them. And I probably will take a big role in finding capital so a small company wants to start something. And also giving guidance how to become like MIT or better than MIT. We're also looking to see if it's in our domain without sometimes saying no, that we should take it and subcontract to some of these guys to bring them up to something so they get some revenue. get more recognized and get more confident.
And last, what is your message to the young generation?
Well, my message is, if you have a dream, stay focused. Everything is going to fall apart, but if you stay focused, he will let you do it.
Until we meet again with another episode of 10 Minutes, keep logging to Digital Academy.